trying to get Kaylee in here. Actually, I would like to, her point of views to be projected because they're good conversation topics. However, she's just very anti-podcast.
Well, thankfully, we're not anti-podcast.
No.
Hello,
we like to podcast.
We do.
Favorite day every 2 weeks.
I feel like we could do it every week if we really wanted to, but man.
Sure.
That'd be rough. All right. Well, hello, Internet. Hello, Twitch. Welcome to the 62nd episode of the IGC podcast, where we curse, talk about video games, and occasionally get wasted while doing it. I'm your host, Gray Geraldin, on this lovely Sunday, April 17th. It is 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, or about. And we are going to talk about games we've been playing and some news that has happened over the past 2 weeks. So now you know who I am. Who else is here in the room with me?
Got Core Contingency, also known as Nadius. I am definitely in here, ready to talk about video game news.
Mm-hmm.
And the AI monster, I'm here, even though I'm a little bit sick right now.
Well, more power to you, sir. Thank you for coming.
Yes, we appreciate your service and your sacrifice.
Please, about to get my 50th platinum.
You make yourself a hot toddy and settle in for a nice podcast here.
Your 50th platinum, and what have we been playing exactly?
Oh my god. You know what? So I've been going through my backlog recently here, and one of the games that I really wanted to finish, never got the chance, was Grand Theft Auto V. Like, I played Grand Theft Auto V a lot online with other people, and I played the single player campaign, but I had a hard drive incident that caused me to have to reinstall Windows. And actually, when I thought GTA V was backing up to the Steam Cloud, that was incorrect. So through the social club, the Steam Cloud, it did not back up my single player saves. And I reinstalled the game, went in there to find out, oh, look, you have to start all over again. And I'm not sure if you guys are familiar with Grand Theft Auto V, but it's a long game.
I have heard it
so,
is.
Yeah. So finally, about a week ago, I settled in, reinstalled it, started playing through again. And that's been one thing I've been doing. I also activated out of my backlog the Telltale Game of Thrones series.
Yeah. How have you been enjoying that one?
So I like it. It is definitely one of the darker Telltale series. They don't pull any punches at all. You know, a lot of surprises. Like, I gotta say, like, people die. This is Game of Thrones. There's a lot of people that die. But I feel like I have no control over it.
You do, like, and you don't.
Like, yeah, I feel like I'm on a scripted path here for a lot of it. Like, there are, you know, main characters dying, and bloody hell, it doesn't matter what diplomacy mission I choose or however I want to, you know, set up some type of military, you know, warrior type counter to the situation we're getting to. I feel like the situation is going to resolve itself in the same way every time. And I think that's my biggest gripe with it, but I am enjoying the story. I'm thoroughly enjoying watching the fall of House Forrester. I think I just finished episode 4, so I got 5 and 6 to go, which now a normal person would say, all right, so you're three, you know, 2/3 of the way through, you've hit rock bottom. But you and I know this is Game of Thrones. No. You have not hit rock bottom, so I know there's only more depressing, despairing shit to come. And I'll probably finish it tonight.
Probably is more depressing. You're actually at the same point that I am.
Yeah.
And I stopped playing it at Extra Life in the fall. I think that at the end of the first chapter, that character who dies, I think that will always happen. And
right. I don't think there's anything you can do to get around
that.
Yeah,
I don't think there is. And one thing that I thought was, yes, it probably is some scripted path, but what they do is they allow you to sort of create this tension within chapters. Like, when you play X character, is there more tension in this chapter based on, did I take this item, did I write this letter, did I do this thing, and take the flack or heat off of other characters so that you can play their chapters a little less stressfully?
Yeah. Now, honestly, the most compelling storylines I've encountered so far are those of, you know, like the exiled son, Asher, and his friend, companion, Baska. Like, their story is way more interesting to me than anybody else, you know? Because there's mystery there. Like, they've got history. You don't know about it, but they've got it. And you're almost reenacting this the camaraderie, this sense of friendship through this history that you don't even know about, but you like, you know, these two characters, they've got the history, so you're just kind of siding with this character the whole time. I don't know if you felt that way at all.
I felt like it wasn't as good a Telltale game as it could have been. Especially the last episode, just kind of not as good as it could have been.
I know, we're talking about a game that's been, what, concluded for like a year now? And we're looking towards a season two. But, you know, like I said, playing the back history, these are the games that come up.
I don't know. There's actually decisions you can make in a game that will cause you to game over and you have to go back and make the decision again, which is terrible in a Telltale game. Don't do that to me.
Didn't actually run into that, but yeah, I haven't played the whole thing yet.
I haven't run into that. I think
I got everybody killed.
I'm pretty sure I made that decision along the way because I'm a proud person and, you know, will not bow down. And I think that's the kind of thing they want you to do in this game. Like they're actively working against the type of person that I am.
Yeah, I mean, the whole game is choices of like fuck the police, basically.
It's either fuck the police or accept the police beating you in the face.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I think the best path taken is to just, you know, take the punches and roll with them and do the best you can. And if you try to be defiant and, you know, the proud race, you're setting yourself up for failure. And I kind of see that now.
Yeah. I mean, I felt like even if it wasn't the best Telltale game, and when I was playing it, the reason I haven't finished it is because it didn't compel me like Wolf Among Us or The Walking Dead Season 1 or 2. But I felt like as a Game of Thrones story, it's very true to what George R. R. Martin wants to convey in a storyline. Like, the righteous die, the good people all get fucked, and the bad people sort of win until they get their day. But everything sort of resolves kind of like, you know, neutrally. Like, you're never really happy with the outcome entirely.
Yeah. I think, like, having read a lot more dark fantasy outside of Feist, like, you know, Abercrombie and so forth, like, I kind of see it now. Like, there's a Abercrombie's got a quote. Like, one of his characters says, you know what, honor doesn't put food in your belly.
That's so
true. That's pretty much how you have to approach this game. Like, if you got to grovel and you know, basically prostrate yourself to your lessers, then do it. You're going to have a better experience from it. But I just can't do that.
Yeah. It's interesting because it sort of fights against everything you'd believe as like an American.
Mm-hmm. Well, and everything we believe from like high fantasy, you know, the honorable, proud warrior always wins. No, that's not how the shit works in the real world. It's just
not at all.
It isn't. And this game will make you remember that. But that's what I've been doing.
Well, that's a good one to hit up on your backlog for sure.
Definitely.
I actually did when I reformatted. That was one of like the five games I did actually reinstall. Thinking, oh, I'm going to get back in. I'm going to finish this once from time
to
time.
No, I'm going to finish. I'm probably going to finish it tonight. I've got 2 chapters to go. I think I can do it.
Well, next time you guys can have a heated debate about how it ended. So, May, you said you're on your 50th platinum. Which one are you platinuming now?
I'm platinuming Ratchet and Clank.
Ah.
Oh.
New release. Okay, so how'd you like it?
I'm really enjoying it. It is a bit short, though. I'm almost done it.
I think we knew that. Like, we were all expecting like a full, you know, Ratchet Clank game. All of a sudden, we saw the price come out. We're like, well, they're charging $40 for this thing. So what's going on here?
What is it, like 6 hours, 8 hours?
If you do everything, it's the platinum is 20 hours, but that's 2 playthroughs. Obviously, the second playthrough is going to be shorter.
So your first playthrough is what? 10 hours?
12, 13, 14.
Okay.
Somewhere in that range.
Well, that's not terrible for the price they're asking.
Yeah, it's not bad.
Yeah, it's definitely a good value for the money. Really enjoying the weapons in the game. It's got a great variety of weapons. Lots of... they could probably do a bit more with the gadgets and mobility and everything. When you get the jetpack, it's probably the most fun in the game because it moves really fast. You can go anywhere.
So you liked it.
There is no game that has ever been hurt for the addition of a jetpack.
I'm sitting here trying to think of one. You might be right about that.
I think I'm right.
So you liked it, and apparently game critics pretty much everywhere also liked it.
Much yes. to my pleasure, it seems like everybody is liking this one.
That's not that. I mean, that's not surprising. I think we knew when we heard it was going to be rebooted.
Yeah.
And how quick it turned around from that announcement and that crowdfunding to already be like in your hands now, it was executed pretty well.
You know, they threw out a, you know, vision kind of gameplay trailer that just wowed everybody. And then I said, okay, if they can accomplish this, this is going to be a spectacular game. And that's, you know, what caused me to actually pick it for my game draft game this year.
It is Insomniac, and they are just amazing with graphics and the sound and everything else.
Yeah, it sounds like a winner. It's you put down as it made it correct at 86. That's pretty damn good.
I would play it. However, there is a new PlayStation 4 coming out soon, so it's everyone's on pretty much buying moratorium right now for buying PlayStations. So that's gonna happen.
Yeah, PlayStations and 900 series sure. Nvidia cards apparently.
Yeah, clearly.
Won't buy those right now.
No.
So what else have you guys been playing?
Like I said, going through Game of Thrones. Playing GTA 5 online again. Playing GTA 5, it actually, once again, was enlightening because not only has, you know, Rockstar expanded on their online mode, and we're going to talk about that later for sure, but they've also been going back and retouching up the single player experience and adding like new missions and experiences in the single player side. So actually, playing back through the game, I was playing like missions I never ran the first time through and actually fleshed out the game a lot better than it was originally. So more power to Rockstar for that one. I mean, God, if you're going to make a ton of money in your fucking game, keep up to date, I guess. And
Yeah, it's good that they reinvested back in the game itself.
Clearly, yeah. They put a lot of effort back into the game.
Oh, very good. Very good.
Gray, what have you been playing?
Oh, well, I've been renovating my kitchen, so I unfortunately have not done anything. I also reformed my computer last weekend, so I didn't exactly...
We all saw that.
I haven't gotten around to any of that, to really getting down into things. Just been playing Final Fantasy XIV, and we did progress in our raid this week. We downed yet another boss, and we're well on our way to, hopefully within the next 2 months or so, finishing up this raid tier. So proud of my raid group, and yeah.
The real question is, how many fish sandwiches did you craft this week?
I don't craft any fish sandwiches. In fact, I beg Seifer to craft them for me, and then he gives them to me pretty much free.
Seifer just gives everybody in the guild a very... He just sits there and crafts fish sandwiches.
Fish for everybody. No, it's good. It's omega-3 fatty acids. It's good for you. You'll be all right.
I mean, I don't know if you guys heard the controversy, but about a month ago, maybe a little more, I asked him to craft me a particular item. And then I told him to add some enhancements to it. And I didn't quite specify to him exactly when to stop in terms of money. So the item itself was about 500,000 gil to make, which was not too much. And I had about 9 mil on me. So I was like, cool, I can afford that. And I said, yeah, just try to, you know, enhance it out a little bit. And he had some really bad luck with the RNG in terms of making the enhancements for it. He finally decided to stop when he was about 9 million in, thankfully, and contact me. So I was actually in debt to him through, I think, the entire month of March and a little bit this month as well. So I'm just getting back on my feet, but he's been nice to me and been giving me free food and items and potions and stuff like that, which has really been helpful for the raid progression. So, yeah, it's been a roller coaster.
Now, was this item a dildo made out of unicorn horns?
No. It was just a ring. It was just a single ring, which wasn't really going to change my gameplay too much, but it was going to be a big improvement. Just, you know, it wasn't like a game changer. And yeah, he just kept blowing up my materia enhancements on it. So it wasn't that great, but I paid him back and I'm in the green now, thankfully. But yeah, I spent basically my entire vacation 2 weeks ago making money to pay him back finally, because I didn't have much time to play past that. And but I'm trying to get into the Fallout expansion. I'm gonna do it this Friday. I've heard a lot of good things, so I wanna have something to talk about next time we come on here, because I think this is like my second time in a row I haven't really had like a game to play. I haven't had anything to talk about. But I have been reading news, You guys ready to talk about that stuff?
I'm ready to talk about some gaming news.
All right. So as is the tradition, we will start talking about the VR news because it seems like every 2 weeks or even more often than that, there's a lot going on between either Oculus, Vive, PlayStation VR. And so now these things are out in the wild for the most part. The Vives haven't quite launched yet, right? But there's people who have them in their hands.
No, they launched.
They launched. Okay, so but they're still they're shipping things pretty regularly now, every day, right?
Yeah, I think there's probably just as much Vives out there in the wild as Rifts right now.
It seems like the Oculus is having trouble getting into people's hands, as we mentioned last time as well, and now
they both are.
Now pre-orders are being pushed way back. Issues. Okay,
but so. Yeah.
These units are...
Where do we start?
Yeah, that's sort of where do we start. Well, let's talk about Oculus and privacy. This was something that we all joked about last year or the year before whenever Facebook bought Oculus for $2 billion. And there was a lot of talk about, oh, this is going to have a lot of Facebook integration. This is going to try to feed me a lot of advertisements, bullshit like that. So the issue is there is... The Oculus is constantly sending data to the Facebook servers in some way, but...
No, it's not.
They say it's not.
But
there is a process Oculus that runs in the background.
That they are not currently sending this data to Facebook. That's not then to say in the future they won't, but they are not presently doing it.
Then why are their packets being sent to the Facebook server?
I've seen no evidence for that.
Well, it seems that the Oculus is pretty smart. It knows when you're wearing it, so that it knows to send up a menu and all that other shit. And it has the capability to send your movements and other things that it's tracking through the motion tracker or the head tracker, whatever, to Facebook. And the idea is that sooner or later, they're going to start serving you ads. But at this point in time, you're saying that they're not.
Well, what we know right now, and a lot of people on Reddit have, you know, confirmed this through actually like developing into the DLLs and you know the packet traffic that's going out, is we know the Oculus is sending its use basically, how you're using it. And they're sending that back to the Oculus servers. We know that it's sending usage statistics from the Oculus store, like how long you look at a product on the Oculus store. Do you buy the product? Do you not buy the product? Do you put it on your favorites list, maybe buy it when it goes on sale? That's the kind of information that's being sent right now.
So they're keeping it in-house within the Oculus store, the Oculus product.
It's marketing information that they're collecting right now. They want to know how people who have an Oculus are using it and what their buying habits are. And frankly, that's not unexpected.
No, because Steam does the same thing. I mean, even if I look offhandedly at a game, it suddenly puts other recommendations because I viewed that other at one game into my queue to look at.
But Steam doesn't sell the data to other companies.
No, because Steam is a private company and an entity unto itself.
Doesn't need to. It's gathering data for itself.
But as it stands, Oculus is not passing this information on to Facebook yet. That's not to say they won't do it in the future. There's always the possibility.
I think there's a great possibility. I mean, if you are Facebook and you paid this much money for this... Billions of dollars, yeah. You're at some point going to say, okay, now that you've refined your product enough with all the data that you've collected for yourself in-house, etc., now we want, you know, data on this particular thing. How often are people... You know, looking at this, and this. And Oculus, are they really going to be able to withstand if that information is requested by Facebook, their parent company at this point?
I mean, no, they can't. Really. I don't think Facebook is going to be interested in that metadata until a much later point.
But they did say that they're considering it in the future, and why would I get that VR headset when I could get two other VR headsets that don't have this issue?
That's a good point.
I think that's the best point. Who doesn't use Facebook or really trust it in any particular way.
No, I'm not on. I do have no Facebook presence. I have no interest in having a Facebook presence. But right now, the Oculus doesn't require a Facebook account. It requires, you know, an Oculus account. And I guess they kind of tie the two into each other at some point. But
so this senator over in Minnesota is making sort of a big deal about all of this stuff about the privacy issues that are coming about. Is this something that I mean, should we be concerned about the future of Oculus and how it deals with the data that it is collecting, where it will go and stuff? Because somebody has read through their privacy policy, and the privacy policy is quite, well, once we have the data, we can basically do whatever anything we want with it, more or less.
Yeah, it's your standard EULA, you know, terms of use. We can do everything, you can do nothing. That's par for the course in this day and age. Find me any EULA that doesn't say otherwise.
But should we be concerned that it's going to Facebook? Specifically to Facebook. We know that Google and Facebook and other data collection agencies also work with the government to give them data as requested. This has been going on for, well, you know, ever since the NSA basically came about. They knew who to go to. Can you think the Oculus has, and this is conspiracy theory stuff, it's just for banter, really.
I don't know. I mean,
does it have the potential to be on that level?
Concerned? Yeah, maybe. I mean, these things have, you know, passive sensors. With the Oculus, it's infrared cameras. With the Vive, it's their laser-based, you know, lighthouse units. These things are capable of mapping out your room, amongst other things. I mean, yeah, there's always concern there, but what are you gonna do? I don't know what I'm gonna do.
But I mean, the Google example you gave, Google's services are free, so they make money off advertising. Why does Oculus?
No, but there's a saying in the industry: if you are not paying for something, you are the product being sold.
Of course,
I think in this case we are.
I paid for an Oculus Rift. It's
you did pay for the Rift, but you're not paying.
I didn't pay for it, but you know, it's almost going to be $800 with the touch controllers and. I mean, that's like if I bought a TV and the TV installed advertisements from itself.
But they do.
They do. Yeah.
No, there's been a huge backlash about like Vizio and other brands of TVs that are constantly monitoring your viewing habits and reporting it back to servers. That's not anything new.
No, it's not. I mean, they've been doing that for years. When we had the Nielsen Awards and shit like that, all throughout the 80s and 90s and stuff like that, like they knew what we were watching. I mean, DVR, you know, my cable service knows what I DVR, when I watch it, when I delete it, all that stuff. I mean, they know what I store and stuff. You know,
The Nielsen ratings were based off surveys from people. I believe they weren't based off.
They're based off Nielsen participants, but there are other data gathering factors. You know, like I said, we've proven that like Vizio and Samsung TVs are sending your viewing habits back to Basecamp. They know.
It's all
just so unless you're a tech-savvy person who is blocking, you know, that traffic on your network, guess what? They know what you're doing.
I'm really not sure why my TV would need to be hooked up to the internet anyway. There's also refrigerators that have Twitter.
Well, the smart TV. Sure why. The smart TVs have, you know, Netflix and Hulu and HBO Go and all those fun things. And, you know, people enjoy those services on their smart TV.
They do.
But your smart TV is also basically selling you out.
It is quite interesting in the age of us paying for services like Hulu, like Netflix, like Amazon Instant Video. We're essentially paying to not watch commercials and to get what we want directly on the screen without having to wait for it or DVR it or whatever the case may be, and also to catch up on things. We're essentially paying to not watch commercials. And I mean, think about Sirius XM radio is the same thing. I mean, we pay, you know, X amount of money per year or whatever to get music that doesn't have commercials. With Spotify, well, it's the same thing.
I have an MP3 player.
All right, but I mean, that's what services are about. You know, if you watch basic cable or basic television, it's... you're watching commercials, and if you DVR'd it, you're probably skipping through the commercials because fuck commercials. We're doing a lot to avoid being, you know, sold things and stuff like that. And now I think the concern is with these new products is that essentially we paid a lot of money for them, like AI is saying. I mean, close to $800 or more for these things before tax, and then they're also trying to then sell us something more later. We're giving them like free surveys. We're giving them free surveys constantly. We've agreed to it in order to use their product. Sketchy.
No, it definitely makes you pause for thought.
It should. And I don't think the average person really cares too much about, you know, when they surf the web or search things in Google that Google is necessarily tracking them or Facebook is looking at what they do or whatever. But, I mean, it is a very real thing and it is happening. It's just a matter of are the people who are looking at this data benevolent individuals?
No, they're relatively uninformed, not uneducated, but uninformed and not savvy to what's going on. And I think a lot of that could be resolved by, the companies who make, the network devices and security devices, Linksys and Cisco, TP-Link and all those companies, that they could certainly increase their firewall rules to say, hey, do you want to allow this outgoing traffic? Like, hey, this traffic is trying to go to Facebook. Do you want it to go there? And say, no, I don't fucking want it to go there.
And then your headset stops working.
Yeah, it's a bad trade-off. This is a concern for the people that are really interested in looking at what's communicating with what. But the reality is that the average person is not even aware that there is a VR revolution happening. In fact, the average gamer is not even aware that the VR revolution is actually happening. And that's kind of a scary thing, considering there are three major headsets coming out this year alone.
No, there were a lot of good graphs that came out this last week. I don't think we highlighted any of them here, but they're there showing that a lot of the gamer base, the console players and the PC players, are aware of the VR headsets, but they don't fully understand them or what they are, what they're about. And, as far as brand recognition goes, there's a lot of disparity there.
I put gamer in quotes for a reason. Because if you're not aware of a VR headset and you call yourself a gamer, you're not a gamer because you're not following games.
Right.
Yeah, that's a
you're
different...
You're just a casual player. You don't call somebody, you don't call somebody the name of something. Like, if you're not a collector if you have one, you collect, three or four things. That doesn't make you a collector. Unless it's really expensive.
I found this graph really interesting because I've been telling people about Google Cardboard for a long time, and I don't think I've ever told somebody about Google Cardboard and they actually knew about it. And, I've told them, hey, go online, go order a Google Cardboard for $5 or $6, whatever the hell it is. I don't think it's not that much. But you'll get an idea. If you've got a modern smartphone, you can go get a Google Cardboard, which has bi-convex lenses and a full split-screen VR experience, and you can get some idea of what this is about. And the fact that 18% of the people polled knew about Google Cardboard, that's amazing.
Yeah,
I can't believe that the Gear VR isn't more known. I mean, that's probably the one that should be known the most since that comes bundled with the new Samsung phones.
You would think so. So for the listeners who aren't looking at the chart, let's give the number. So this is a Nielsen Games took a survey of 2,000 teens/adults, what they say over the age of 13, who are also gamers, consider themselves gamers. That word is not operationally defined anywhere in here. In this article, I would have to look at the actual research article, but don't have access to that right now. And they have a little chart here that shows what percentage of those people were aware of X device. So as Nadius had said, the Google Cardboard is at 18%, the Samsung VR 16%. The Oculus Rift is the highest one out of all these at 22%. And that's not, surprising it's the highest one, but surprising at how low it is. Like, that's less than a quarter of gamers.
No, the next value is the most shocking.
Yeah, well, the HTC the Vive at 6% is pretty bad.
For what everybody in pretty much gaming journalism and anybody who's up to speed in VR is saying is the premier VR experience is only 6%.
Yeah. And so this all amounts to 37% of all gamers are aware of at least one VR or AR device. And that number is pretty damn low. And, when Palmer Luckey was talking about how these guys, they need to unify and not look at each other like they're enemies or, on opposite sides of the fence here. None of these companies have done a very good job at actually advertising VR. I mean, I don't see a single VR commercial, during primetime. There wasn't one during the Super Bowl. That's when you teach people about your product, and it's not just one company, it's all companies that need to get together and say, hey, this is the thing that's happening. And it's even coming out for PlayStation, and the PlayStation VR only had a 14% mention in this poll.
Yeah. Marketing has been a huge problem. Recently there has been a extremely, extremely good video that Valve produced about the HTC Vive that just came out 2 weeks ago. And shows very clearly with green screen and the VR world transposed over the green screen with the player inside of it that shows what these things are capable of. And that's the kind of advertising you have to get out there to the public. And I'll find the video for you guys to watch and maybe we'll post it in the podcast link. But yeah, the fact that this marketing effort has not been as widespread as it should be is worrying to me for VR.
Yeah.
To be fair, the PlayStation VR is not out yet. Any other ones that are higher up are out. So.
It's not. But they have trailers out there. They've been talking about it since the PlayStation Experience.
There's
going to be more about it this year.
Only among gamer reviews. I mean, it's not. They're probably poised to release commercials and things for PlayStation VR.
Well, here's the biggest thing.
I'm surprised Oculus hasn't.
As much as I hate to give credit to GameStop, you know, we've mentioned time and time again, and I've been a proponent of this, that in order for me to get on board with VR, and I think the average person to now not forget about get on board, just know about it. This stuff needs to be in GameStop. It needs to be in Best Buy, etc. And now, 10 GameStop locations, 10 are actually going to have HTC Vive demos available in the store. So here are the locations, more or less. So the one in Plano, Texas, New York, New York, Latham, New York, Washington, Oregon, Chicago, Illinois, Orlando,
so
Florida.
Basically large population.
Yeah, large population places are now going to actually have one store in their area where you can actually demo an HTC Vive. Which is fantastic, because this will help with the exposure at the very least, and so that people fucking know that, yeah, there's actually this thing called VR that exists, and hey, look, you can try it out right here. That's finally what we want. That's what was needed for this, and that number, 22%, is really bad for Oculus.
Yeah, the VR rollout has been lackluster, as you know, as far as the advertisement is concerned, and I think maybe that might be for the better, because we're already seeing you can't buy one of these things right now.
And I wonder if that was the catalyst for all that. You know, like, well, this is what we're going to be able to produce in X amount of time. So if we advertise this too much, we are going to have a PR nightmare on our hands, even more so than we already have.
Right.
You got to wonder if it was built into the strategy.
So look, you know, the guys who order the Oculus day one, within the first like 20 minutes, their ship dates have been moved from March to late May, early June. So there's obviously, you know, materials requisition concerns there. So I mean, advertising this thing at this point, what advantage is it going to give you? Yeah, it gets the public interested in it, but they can't buy one.
Well, now maybe they'll become interested in it. And with E3 coming around, now that this is the first E3 where
there's already enough people interested in it. They're selling every unit they can make.
Yeah,
so what advantage is there to getting more people interested?
Well, maybe they'll get some investment companies interested in putting some money in to help them produce these things quicker.
You've got Valve and HTC. And they seem to be doing just fine. And you've got Oculus and Facebook. They seem to be doing just fine. I don't think it's about money at this point.
They just need more time.
They need more time. Probably happened too early.
Probably. Yeah, probably. Maybe they should have waited till June, July, you know, to have a little bit more of a stock before doing this. But it is what it is, and it's out there now. And
the people who have
some people's hands,
they're enjoying the ever-living shit out of them.
Yeah, I'm really glad. I would love to, love to be able to check it out and have some educated thoughts on this. But
yeah, I ordered my Vive 2 hours after the pre-orders went live, and I do not have a ship date yet. So
going back to the whole idea that these companies need to be as one, we've seen a lot of games come out that are like Oculus exclusive or Vive exclusive, and that's been a problem.
No Vive exclusives.
No, Vive doesn't operate on exclusives. Right,
Vive does not operate exclusive. There are definitely Oculus exclusives.
We've covered this like in the
like
past.
30
like,
of them.
We've talked about
HTC Vive, they want to make this entire economy of VR games as approachable from any platform as possible. And, you know, Valve has gone to great lengths. They've been developing new technology and releasing it. You know, they gave their huge performance increase technology. Like, they just gave it to the Unity engine. They're like, here you go. Enjoy it. Where we've seen the Oculus guys being very cloistered, and playing their cards very close to their chest. Like, these are our games, and these are Oculus exclusives, and they may come out on other VR platforms at some point, but you can play them now on the Oculus, even though you can't buy one.
Well, some guy's making that happen, right?
Right. Yeah. As we figured was going to happen,
because it's on PC.
Yeah, it's on a PC. So you've got some very talented people out there making mods, modifying executables, tying executables into the libraries of the two platforms, the Oculus VR and the HTC. And so they are releasing patches for games where you can play a Oculus exclusive on HTC Vive.
Warms my fucking heart.
Well, it's how it should be. Warm Oculus's heart. Though,
oh, of course not.
They unfortunately made their Oculus Store an open environment where anybody can go download the Oculus Store, install it on their machine, and grab these Oculus exclusive games and bring them down. Except now there's patches to make these Oculus exclusive games playable on the Vive. And these Vive players did not buy into the Oculus economy, and now they're playing their games for free.
Yeah, but they're still taking advantage of it, right? So,
well, that's good.
Yeah.
These companies need to operate like pieces of hardware. I mean, if you're trying to fragment the player base already, that's going to be a real problem. So Vive has the right idea. Valve has the right idea with creating this open platform and making SDKs and everything for developers to release on both Oculus and Vive and any other PC VR that comes out later that could potentially support. And Oculus has the wrong idea. I mean, it's just gonna cause VR adoption to be slower. And right now, they should be focused on making VR adoption as quick as possible.
That's right.
That was the original intent, honestly, between Oculus and Valve. Like, they worked together for a long time developing the technology and the platforms behind this. And to see Oculus go off on their proprietary closed environment with their exclusive games was heartbreaking to me, honestly. It fucking broke my heart.
Yeah.
And thanks, Facebook.
I apologize. Yeah, I apologize.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I mean, it was truly a huge detrimental blow to the industry. Like, we're trying to get VR out there. Those of us who've experienced it and played it know how groundbreaking this technology is, and we know it has to get out there to the masses. It has to be out there in any form. Be it you buy an Oculus Rift or an HTC Vive or even a PSVR, like, these games need to be available. There has to be games. Like, why are you going to buy this hardware without good games behind it? And the fact that you can sit there and say, well, I could buy the Oculus and have these games, or I could buy the HTC Vive and have these games, that's fragmentation. That's, you know, splitting the community between platforms, and it's just a terrible idea when you're trying to get a new technology out there.
Yeah, I mean,
like, when we brought the 3D accelerators to the market, like back in, you know, late 90s, 98, 99, nobody was sitting there saying, well, 3DFX was actually, but a lot of the 3D accelerator companies were working together. They worked with Microsoft to develop the Direct3D platform, OpenGL to develop the OpenGL environment. These cards worked across all these games. So if you bought a 3D accelerator, there was a pretty good chance your game would work. With these VR headsets, they're trying to fragment the communities, and that's not the way you sell a platform.
And we're going to see this come up again with when PlayStation VR hits too, because a lot of those games are only going to be locked to the Sony PlayStation platform. They're not going to be necessarily available on PC, although Sony says that they're thinking about that and they're going to bring that over, so, which would be great. I think that they need to do that. Those games are going to be lower resolution quality, etc. But if they're good experiences, that matters. I mean, we even now are seeing Microsoft, and we talked a little bit about this last time, although now it's more official. Microsoft is also saying, hey, Sony, hey, Nintendo, we want to talk about crossplay between our platforms now. You know, and that's something we were going to talk about later, but it's worth mentioning now because it's Microsoft saying the same thing that Oculus needs to say and that Vive has already said, that, listen, we're all in this together. We already have separate platforms and user bases. Why not? But they all have the same games. Why don't we just bring it all under one roof, you know? Let people be loyal to Microsoft or Sony or Nintendo or whatever, but let's have crossplay because it doesn't make sense not to. We're all gamers, etc.
I still want to point out that Microsoft was the one who originally denied crossplays.
Of course. I will concur with that. They were steadfast against it.
They were.
The topic had been broached numerous times by Sony and Nintendo, and Microsoft was steadfast, saying, this is our castle. We're going to hold it.
Yeah, but it's like I said last time.
Nintendo ever did.
It's what I said in the last podcast. Like, it's not unlike Microsoft to backpedal on a policy that they then recognize is fucking stupid. I mean,
you know what?
Let's face it.
But I give him respect for that. Like, to realize your position is stupid and to retreat from it and accept a position that's more applicable to the greater good, that's better than just holding steadfast to your position of stupidity.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, the only thing you can really get them on is the timing of all this, right? I mean, we now know a year and a half later, we're looking at them and saying they're not really doing that well. Yeah, of course they want to be the ones.
PlayStation 4 has outsold the Xbox One, you know, 2-1. Like, we can say that now, but... Again, the greater
good. Of course, they're extending the olive branch because essentially in order to stay alive, they need to do that. Or we could just look at it at face value and say, yeah, that's great for them. And if Oculus could do that, that would be good for them too. They really, I mean, it just feels like the way that Palmer Luckey really feels about it and the way that Oculus actually operates are not in line with one another. They're not congruent. You know, if he wants VR to be a thing, then we have to break down these walls in between these platforms. We really do. So let's get into game news because we have a little bit of that. Let's start off right away by talking about Final Fantasy VII. So we heard last year that there was going to be a remake for that game, and everyone was, you know, excited or something about it. I don't know. And we also then later learned on that it was going to be an episodic experience. So that raised a lot of questions and concerns about the length of those episodes, the amount of those episodes, how frequently were they going to come out, et cetera, et cetera. But now... A report over on... What site did we put down here, May? Destructoid. Oh, okay. And Naughty, yes.
Oh, maybe not.
Well, no. It was May. All right. So this article over at Destructoid is now saying that these games, these sections of the game are actually going to be like the size of like full-scale Final Fantasy games.
Right. I wanted to put this up here, but I didn't even know what to make of this story because... The quotes coming out of like Square were just off the wall. They were just like silly and unintelligible.
What does that even mean, a full Final Fantasy game?
That's what I'm saying.
I'm not sure.
Like, there's that Game Boy game that you could beat in 4 hours.
So here's what I got from this one. They're saying, we are remaking Final Fantasy VII, but it's going to be a new game and it's going to be spread over several parts.
But they also say at the same time that we're not going to go crazy on modifying the story because it already has an established story. We're going to stick to it. So how then what do you say? Like, it's going to be four episodes. Let's say it's three episodes. And because the game was on like three discs, I believe, maybe four.
Yep.
Do you then break it up, say more or less into four giant episodes where, you know, you do all that stuff up to like, you know, the death of one of the primary characters. Then do you do the next big thing, you know, and then you do the next big, like, I'm confused on the development of this game. Do they really know what they want to do? And does that line up with what all the PR stuff that they're putting out is saying? Like, what is a fucking full scale Final Fantasy? What does that mean? Is it 40 hours, 30 hours?
How much are they going to have to pad this out to make it, if they're trying to make it 30, exactly. 40 hours episode to episode, and you're like only doing Midgar for the first episode, for example?
Well, let's break it down here. I mean, if you go to like how long to beat, you know, they say the main story of Final Fantasy VII is about 38 and a half hours. That's the main story. If you want to do a completionist run, then you're looking at 90 hours. And let's face it, if you're serious about Final Fantasy VII, you're doing a completionist run.
Sure. And 90 hours is a long time to play a video game for. It's a really long time.
Very, very seldom see that. I can name a few games off of one hand, like Baldur's Gate, Dragon Age Origins, you know, Skyrim. Games that take Skyrim.
I can name 100 games that are over 100.
I will avoid the Elder Scrolls games, well, as always.
Yeah, JRPGs tend, the older ones tended to be pretty long. But are they gonna? They're really gonna make this one longer?
I'm like, looking at like hardcore Western RPGs when you get into that length. But I think they're really, really willing to split this game into like two or three games. Like, they're not doing expansions. They're not doing, you know, episodes. They're gonna release like two or three games.
I don't see them.
You think so?
That's what I got from the quotes. They're not willing to do expansions. They're not going to do DLC. They're going to release two or three games.
So like a Final Fantasy 13 type thing.
Mm-hmm. I mean, there's still a lot of questions up in the air. Are these going to be full price games?
Yes. Now,
how is the transition between one episode and the other going to work? Like, is it going to carry over completely?
Well, I mean, we know from the PC release stuff that Square Enix does have cloud saving involved, and you know, if there's a way to go from essentially looking at that Blu-ray as disc one, you know, and then the next one as disc two and whatever. I mean, they can make that happen. It's just that the length of the game concerns me. I mean, if it will indeed be like Final Fantasy VII 1, 2, and 3, like in a row, and you're going to pay $60 for each one of them, essentially, you're going to pay close to $200 for one game, essentially.
That sounds like a good deal for Square.
Don't forget the three like collector's editions you're going to buy.
Oh,
obviously.
Gee, don't even.
Oh, of course. With the chocobo fucking rideable spring pony or whatever you're going to get.
Yeah, we're going to give you an Eris statue and a Red 13 plushie. Yeah. Forget it. It's going to go like off the wall because it's Square Enix.
They don't give you a lot of the collector's editions. They just charge $200 for something cheap.
Can you give a Red 13 plushie? I'd buy one.
I don't know, but I own like every single Moogle plushie they've ever fucking sold, so.
I'm all about a Red 13 plushie.
All right, so yeah. All right, let's talk about Baldur's Gate. So Baldur's Gate expansion recently came out, which was kind of out of left field for, I think, everybody. And it featured a transgender character, and this was this caused some controversy among people who are dumb. And so Wizards of the Coast has finally said something about it, and they've decided to throw support behind the character, where at first people were saying that, oh, this character doesn't seem to fit into the, you know, the whole lore of this particular world that they're trying to talk about, and, you know, is it Forgotten Realms, right? Baldur's Gate is Forgotten Realms.
The whole fantasy genre, I mean.
Yeah, yeah.
You can't have a transgender character now.
Again, people that are dumb. on the internet, they started to harass a female employee. So let's take it from there.
Well, we gotta go back here. So we gotta go back to the actual expansion and the character that this whole thing spun around.
It's a transgender character.
Yes.
And people apparently had problems with there being a transgender character in a video game.
Mm-hmm.
And I would question why. Perhaps I'm more liberal than the average gamer.
Well, I will say that
Wizards
of the Coast came out and basically substantiated this entire character based upon the world that these games exist in. And they said, and I quote, "You don't need to be confined to binary notions of sex and gender. The elf god Corallon the Therian is often seen as androgynous. For example, and some elves in the multiverse are made in Corallon's image. You could also play a female character who presents herself as a man who feels trapped in a female body, or a bearded female dwarf who hates being mistaken for a male. Likewise, your character's sexual orientation is for you to decide." And that is a direct quote from the Wizards of the Coast people.
Yeah, it's right out of the player's handbook.
Right.
Which was an absolutely eloquent response for them, you know.
Agreed.
To have something that was printed way before this controversy came about. And I feel like the people who were complaining about this, maybe they're just not D&D people. Maybe they're just Baldur's Gate people who Could think be. This is the game.
Maybe
that
they're
they
fucking
play.
Idiots.
Maybe they're idiots. Yes. Maybe they're just dumb.
I think there are a lot of people who are not comfortable with their own sexuality, frankly.
Yes, I would agree with you on that particular statement, having worked with many people who are uncomfortable with their own sexual identities.
Look, dude, I play D&D. I don't know if you guys have. I think you have. But I've also played with a lot of other people who play D&D. We played male and female characters and were capable of role-playing those characters in an applicable environment. And we get by. Does anybody care at the end? Like, does anybody look at me and say, oh, like, you play a female character, clearly you're a fucking... inclined to, you know, cross-dress and be transgendered? No, of course not. It's a role-playing environment. Yeah. Sometimes we play characters that fit the story.
Yeah, sometimes male characters play chicks.
You don't even have to play this character. It's just you have a dialogue with this character.
Yeah, this is history for you, folks. Guess what? Men play female characters. It's happened before. Sometimes female characters play male characters. Oh my God. Enlightenment.
Yeah, it's crazy, isn't it? And so, to not be outdone, the idiots that harass people on the internet, which we will not name, had a problem with Wizards' very appropriate response to this all and decided to turn their ire instead to one of the writers of Beamdog.
Well, of course.
Because, you know, we were wrong, but we need to be mad still.
You can't attack the position, attack the person.
Of course.
Not even, just attack the... They're singling out a person because they're female.
Yeah, if you can't attack the position, attack the person.
And so the company defended her and did right by her, and yes, talking about how, you know, they don't condone these kinds of actions and stuff like that. And that's good on them, because that is how it should have been. Period. And if you are the kind of person who takes offense to there being a transgender character in your video game, you need to go outside more.
Agreed. I played a lot of D&D. Played a lot of D&D with, you know, people around a table and people in online, you know, virtual communities. And never once was any character who wanted to play a character of the opposed, like, gender to what, you know, their actual physical person is, ever been attacked. Like, I can't even imagine. Like, it's so silly.
Yeah. It's the people who, sometimes people who look for visual stimulation and video games, they don't play those classics. You know, they're not about reading. They're not about understanding the things that are going on. They're not about lore necessarily. You know, they speed through journals and other things in the games. They don't really care about that stuff. They're about gameplay. And to them, this particular thing felt to them like it didn't belong part of the gameplay.
Like World of Warcraft vanilla players.
Yes. I'm not even going to touch that with a, with a 10-foot pole.
Oh, God, find me 5 World of Warcraft vanilla players who actually read the quest they played.
I could find you, like, 20.
You had to read the quest during
You just look at the little blip on your radar that says, go here.
There was no blip on the radar back then.
Yes, there was.
No, there wasn't. There was no quest markers whatsoever. You had to read the quest to figure out where to go.
It's quickly added, though.
No, it wasn't. It wasn't added until Wrath of Lich King, and that was a mod.
Yeah, well, nowadays...
They didn't add it until Cataclysm, I guess, as a default feature.
Well, nowadays, everyone looks for that kind of stuff, you know? It's pretty sad.
But, continuing along that same vein...
Yes, okay.
What's going on with Rust?
Okay, so I was trying to figure this one out, but I can't. Okay, so apparently there's a game called Rust. Okay, it's a survival game. It's been on Steam for a while.
Oh, yes. Early access. Survival game. Been in early access.
So, you know, it's got character generation and stuff like that. But apparently the character that you are assigned is just generated for you based off of your Steam ID now. By, I suppose, the Rust servers, Steam, some partnership there. So you can very easily be a male and get generated a female character. Or a female player and get a male character, or whatever the case may be.
Not just that, but you might be a black female character.
Oh,
or
boy.
Asian female character, or an Asian male, or a black male.
Oh, the rage.
Oh, so terrible. So, has there been any backlash about this? Because I...
Oh, yes. Yes. Okay. More than Baldur's Gate, probably.
So, do we want to continue to talk about dumb people? That's the question.
It brings forth an interesting question. So in a online world or environment, should you get the opportunity to portray your character as you envision it, or do you let the game decide how your physical presence is portrayed to other people?
That's an interesting question. I think that there's value in either of those. I feel that people in our society who feel that choice is, you know, absolutely the most paramount thing that you need to protect and have all the time, your individual freedom in that sense, they might have a big issue with that. But I think there is a lot of value in seeing the other perspectives as well, you know, other genders, other races, and how players in the game might respond to you based on you being an Asian female when really you're a white guy sitting behind the screen.
Right, and that's the interesting question here. Because I think that's almost the experiment that the Rust people decided to undertake. Because for the longest time, Rust is an early access game. It's not released yet. It's still in early access. And for a very long time, every character in the game was portrayed as a white male.
It says it was released on Steam December 11th, 2013. It says nothing. Oh, no, it still says early access game.
Yeah, it's been in early access for a while.
It's been out for a while.
The release was the early access launch date.
Over 2 years it's been.
Oh, God, it gets worse than that. We can talk about early access survival games till Kingdom Come, dude. There's a million of them.
There are a million of them. They're all in early access.
But this one is unique in particular, because for the longest time, your character's persona, your avatar, was a white male. And so all of a sudden they decided to introduce diversity into the game. And they decided, you know what? We're going to randomly generate it for you.
Like the rest of the game.
I love it too. I think it's great. But a lot of people don't.
It is an interesting social experiment, and I hope that whatever data they gather from it, whether they're doing it on purpose or not, they use it wisely, and they report something about it. That's what I would hope.
You know, the funny thing was, like, the early days of the survival game, which, let's fucking face it, was like the original DayZ for the Arma 2 mod. An Arma 2 mod called DayZ. You didn't pick your race or your gender or your color. You just played a character. And nobody seemed to care. Nobody had any problems with that. And so I'm wondering what the heck happened along the way where all of a sudden we've got these new survival games where people are so all of a sudden very concerned about their character's persona. Because in DayZ, you're lucky if you survive 2 days of real-world gameplay.
Yeah, who you're personifying really had little effects on anything.
No, it didn't matter. Like, you could be dead tomorrow. And you get a new character. Who cares?
Well, I guess we'll see if they change their policy going forward or whatnot. Here's a cute story.
I saw this one.
I hope you guys watched this video because it's very interesting. So apparently there was an Easter egg that was discovered in Mike Tyson's Punch-Out, the original game for NES. And it's a short video on YouTube, about 4 minutes, of a guy who shows that the game actually has a tell for when you are supposed to execute those punches to take out some of the late game boxers.
Right. This is about like some audience member who ducks at like the most opportune moment.
Yeah, and it's a very, very short, like maybe a frame or two change in the background. But if you notice it, it is the game telling you essentially how to actually defeat the opponent. And it's quite interesting. You should go watch it on YouTube. Let's see. You should search for Mike Tyson's Punch-Out Easter Egg / Secret is what it's called. And he shows off a fight in E-Honda and Bald Bull as well. So take a look at that, because if you love that game like I did growing up, and you spent countless hours trying to figure out exactly when to do that stuff, and you didn't notice it, you know what? The whole time the game was actually telling you how to play it, which is actually good game design.
Phenomenal game design, but yeah, but the fact that we're finding it 20 plus years later is kind of questionable.
Yeah, it was
great game design.
It was hidden a little too well.
It wasn't designed specifically to help the player out.
But it's there. It's there if you look for it, and this guy found it, and it's a good video. Okay, so we had mentioned, I think we mentioned this one on the podcast last time, that there was some controversy about one of Tracer's victory poses in Overwatch, where a father wrote an open letter to Blizzard on their forums that she was showing a little too much butt, and that he didn't want his daughter growing up in a world or something like that where women were hypersexualized the way they are, and, you know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It was quite long. And Blizzard responded to him saying that they would definitely look into changing the actual pose. And
apparently the criticism was more about the pose not fitting the character.
Right, not being her personality.
Had the same pose, but that kind of fits her character more.
Right. So people look at Tracer as a more sophisticated type of female, intelligent, agile, energetic, yeah. And so they didn't feel that this straight-up butt pose was what it became called across the internet fit the character's personality. And that's all well and good. I guess you could try to make an argument for that, whatever. And Blizzard responded and said that they would definitely look into changing the victory pose. And so they have. And looking at this DualShockers article, I'm looking at the before and after. I feel like the after is actually more sexy than the before.
They copied. This is great for Blizzard.
There's more butt now.
Yeah, they actually copied a pinup poster for the pose.
That is what it looks like. Yes,
it's kind of a take on that, I guess.
So before, she's kind of standing with her back turned to the camera, with her right hip kind of raised, one gun in the air, one by her side, kind of showing off her butt. In this one, she's got both her. She's sort of half turned towards the camera over her shoulder, and her butt is sticking out, and she's got her right leg up like she's like a pinup poster, yeah, essentially. And she's looking backwards to the camera with sort of a winky kind of eye look thing. So I think it's even sexier than the last one, and I wonder how that dad feels about all of this. Got his 15 minutes of fame, and I don't think he got what he wanted.
I would love to know how that male dad feels about ballet. Because, honestly, like male ballet dancers, they try to achieve that look.
That standing on one leg kind of look?
No. Okay, so like a male ballet dancer is trying to define like the definition between like the gluteus maximus muscles, and it achieves a very similar look. There is a clear definition between the two buttocks, is what I'm saying, and that is the like ideal male ballet form. So, are you saying that the male ballet form is not applicable to a female character in a game?
I don't know what they're saying. I mean, I'm certainly not saying anything. I think that the pose is fine either way. I think the new pose is better than the last one, regardless of whether her butt is more enhanced or whatever. I think, I don't know. I don't play Overwatch. I don't know what the character's personality is, except offhandedly. And I would say that this probably one probably does fit her personality better. And overall, it's a better animated pose. I don't know if Blizzard knows anything about male ballet. Maybe they do.
I think maybe they do. I don't know. But I'm just saying, like, we want to hold double standards. Okay, that's fine. So the female character cannot define their buttocks, but the males in modern ballet can. So where are you drawing the definition here? Like, one is a culturally accepted, you know, art form, and the other is a video game. So
again, Widowmaker has the same pose as her. They just update the pose to be unique to her now.
No, seriously, like in male ballet, it is like undesired to have what they call the unibutt. Like, you don't the want unibutt. Seriously, it's like a uniform butt. So we're saying in a video game, a female character cannot, you know, base that persuasion?
Nobody said that.
Well, I think what you should do is you should write an open letter to Blizzard and ask them what their feelings are.
Again, Widowmaker has that same pose.
No, I agree. I'm saying the pose is fine. It doesn't matter. And define it as you will. Who cares?
I think this is all just...
this is the human body. Like, accept it, folks. Yeah, this is how it works. When you have a well-toned human body, this is how it looks.
Accept the human body. Accept the human body when it's animated. And please try to accept the fact that there's a sexual continuum as well, because that does exist, whether you know about it or not. Let's move on to talk a little bit about the industry, because there has been quite a buzz in the industry lately. So this damn article, it was loading and now it's not loading and whatnot.
Mm-hmm. We're talking about how streaming has a positive influence on game sales.
Yeah, so NPD posted this, right?
Yes, they did.
Were you able to get the article back up?
I'm trying to now. It's not coming up.
There's some good statistical data. Oh wait, I have it up on my my other browser.
Excellent.
All right, so I'm going to give some cliff notes on this one, and maybe we can have a few talking points out of here. So the NPD group said that 44% of current gamers have watched either formal esports competitions or informal video streaming of gameplay sometime in the past 6 months. So why is this important? Well, it's important because we need to recognize that streaming actually is kind of a bigger deal than Nintendo, for example, would give it credit for. A lot of people go and watch streams to get an idea about the game. They like to watch competitions that people have about games that they're particularly interested in. And they also watch a lot of games that they're not necessarily totally involved in.
Agreed. And they produce statistics that are reasonable and just and balanced on all of them. And they have produced some very interesting statistics here on people who watch these live streams, how to plays, and with a direct correlation to their sales. And they found that the sales go up.
Now, to be fair, the sales would probably go down on a game that is linear and a couple hours long. And
so we've touched on that. Yeah, we touched on that, like with last podcast, that Dragon Cancer. There was the developer of the game claimed and we haven't substantiated it, that the sales of his game were directly affected by you know, Let's Plays, because his game was relatively short, like a 2 or 3 hour experience. So he claimed that because people could watch the entirety of his game, why would they go buy it?
Here's my response to this. Don't make a walk-in simulator as a linear. And you'll have better sales. I mean, it's just as simple as that. If somebody could watch your entire game on YouTube, then you're not going to be able to silence that. So you get, as much as you could try.
I mean, it is what it is. There are some other interesting things that were talked about in this article as well. They said that the average gamer who actually watches streaming watches for about 3 hours per session.
That's a lot.
Hesitant to say that they're watching the whole time. But 80% watch some form of video game play on a daily basis, and the other 46% watch something weekly. Which is interesting. Even when focused on competitive esports, it's the game being played that consistently attracts viewers. Watchers are most influenced by the game, followed by the quality of the commentators and the team slash players. And the size of the tournament and the actual size of the prize pool actually had an insignificant role in attracting viewers. Which is funny because whenever the big news that came out of the last Dota tournament last year, right, was about how big that fucking prize pool was. It was like, what, 25 million or whatever it was? They were dividing between the top three place teams or whatever. And that was, to us, the big talking point, right? But that's not what got people to actually watch the Dota tournament, which is really interesting the way that, it, you know, the people who are participating in it view that particular event, and then how the people report on it view that event.
I think it's funny how they define gamers compared to Nielsen. There's obviously a difference
here. Yeah, oh yeah, there's a big difference here. And this the way that they gathered this data was actually an online survey, males and females, ages 9 and older.
With parents' permission.
With parents' permission, of course, yeah. So, yeah, really, really interesting stuff there. Streaming matters to get your games sold. So yes, someone should tell Nintendo to let people make YouTube videos of the game.
And I think that's the best point we can take from this.
And Capcom and Square Enix and loads of the companies.
Well, but nobody is nearly as aggressive as Nintendo at shooting down the Let's Plays.
Capcom and Square Enix are pretty aggressive. Just about as aggressive as Nintendo, I mean. They spend a lot of money.
All right, I stand corrected.
They do. They spend a lot of money. In Jim Sterling's most recent video, he did some shots of Link on the 3DS where he blurred the crap out of the actual gameplay. And he put a little funny clip across the screen and said, like, try to whatever this Nintendo or like, you know, their automated system looking for like gameplay similarities and whatever. There's apparently some way to, you know, make sure that you can avoid that kind of stuff. But you gotta go above and beyond.
I think the bottom line here is getting your game out there and exposed to other players, other potential players, is nothing but a positive.
Right. Nothing but positive.
Maybe they could sell some Wii U's.
Well, if they don't stop making them, right?
Well, we'll talk to Papa about that one.
All right. So we were very quick to write off Fable Legends last time, so I'm glad that you put that here on the document. So last time on the podcast, we talked about how there was a lot going down over at Lionhead UK, and Fable Legends was basically being, it was ended. It was going to be over with, and we talked a little bit about how the game had changed over the course of its lifetime.
And there's been some contention about the game itself.
Indeed it did. But now Lionhead and Microsoft are talking again, and they're going to talk about making Fable Legends a reality. So, I mean, how little we had good to say about Fable Legends on this podcast.
I had nothing bad to say about it. I'll just maintain that point.
So there's nothing good to say about it.
No, I don't agree with that.
Okay, well, tell me something good about it.
So, we talked about Fable Legends, and AI Monster Melee kind of maintained that it was, you know, a MOBA. And I disagreed. I said, no, this isn't a MOBA. This is something a little bit different. It has some elements that they've adopted from MOBAs and some elements that they've adopted from, you know, standard, like, DM-based RPGs, where this is an asymmetrical RPG, basically.
Yeah.
And it's basically, there's one person who's kind of acting as a dungeon master and four players who are running through his dungeon. Now, a lot of the gameplay tends to resemble a MOBA, and May is correct there. But I think this is something different, and it was something I was really interested in. I really wanted to see this game come to fruition, and I was disappointed when I found out it might get canceled.
What genre is it if it's not a MOBA? I mean, just because it's asymmetrical.
Asymmetrical RPG.
No, it doesn't make it.
No, I will define it as asymmetrical RPG.
I mean, it could not be a genre. They could be trying to make something of it.
Good God! Heaven forbid somebody else try to come up with a new concept.
Well,
you can't argue the fact that there was one player who was a dungeon master, and he had four adventurers, right? So four adventurers, one dungeon master, even though they're on standardized maps that resemble MOBA maps, there's an interesting experience that could happen there. And to just, you know, get the game cut and dismissed and gone when it had received so much press and actually positive press really fucking saddened me.
Well, it became kind of this is what this game is about. This is the new features we're adding. And then this game started to look like something that less and less people wanted over time. And to the point where people stopped caring. Like, I mean, the game went into like a closed beta that, from what I recall, and maybe my memory is fuzzy on this, not too many people really cared much about. And those that didn't have really anything crazy to say about it in terms of positivity. It just kind of existed, and it seemed formless, and it was an idea that there would be a Fable game that wasn't anything like Fable, essentially. It was just a game that was carrying the Fable tag. And I don't think that was enough to attract
people. It's very much like that. It exists in that Rainbow Six, you know, Tom Clancy world, right, where we're just attaching a name to it. It doesn't have anything to do with anything that, you know, the originals produced, but... You know, we get an idea from Fable. It's going to be a colorful world, you know, with interesting abilities and characters, and they're going to do fun things. And so this idea that you had a DM and four players, you know, competing against that DM, that interested me. And it's sad that they shut it down, but hey, maybe they didn't.
Maybe they didn't. Maybe it's come back. And I think the short of it is that if you were looking forward to Fable Legends, there's a possibility that that game may be salvaged and will be on your shelf and your computer whenever, some point in the distant future at this point.
Maybe.
Because who knows when that game was coming out originally anyway.
Right.
Okay, so there's been some more discussion. We know that the PlayStation 4K is going to be talked about in October.
Yeah, that's happening.
And there has been many, many rumors floating around about what Xbox is going to do, what Microsoft is planning. Is it going to be an Xbox 1.5? Is it going to be an upgradable console? Is the Xbox going to be games as a service? Like, what is it going to be?
So,
well,
we're pretty sure,
who knows?
We're pretty sure at this point it's going to be the Xbox Slim.
So they're going to release another Xbox that's a little more powerful and is a little bit smaller.
No more powerful, just smaller.
Just smaller. That is smaller, about the most disappointing news that could come out of this.
Do you expect anything else from Microsoft at this
point? No. I have literally no expectations.
Microsoft, who is not even dared to attach themselves to this whole VR thing.
They did the same thing with the 360.
A year later and change their stance completely like they always do.
That's right. So we'll find out next March.
Next podcast, actually, we'll be talking about the new Xbox 4K.
That's right. Which will now actually play Blu-rays well and all that other stuff.
Oh, they do not like the Blu-ray at all, do they?
They do not. They do not dig on the Blu-ray. All right.
Do you remember the whole Xbox 360 debacle with like the HD DVD Blu-ray?
Very well. And then Disney and porn was like, we're doing Blu-ray. Sony was like, yeah, it's too.
And that was that.
That was that. That's all you need to have on board. All right. So there's a lot of Rockstar news. I am experiencing dry mouth from this damn medication. So Anonis, why don't you take us through some of this?
Oh, man. All right. Rockstar has been going through some interesting times here. So we reported back many months ago about the Rockstar North president, Leslie Benzies, who had departed Rockstar, apparently of his own free volition. That is apparently not the case anymore.
So he says.
Yeah, so Leslie Benzies has actually taken up legal suit against Rockstar for upwards of $150 million in unpaid royalties. He claims that he was terminated prematurely against his contract. He did not leave Rockstar of his own volition, and he is entitled to said royalties. Rockstar has filed a countersuit saying he resigned without good reason. Now, that's very, all interesting.
Very descriptive countersuit.
Because of these court documents, we can get some insight into Rockstar's Grand Theft Auto V, which we have now learned has generated more than $3 billion in sales. $500 million of which have been from online microtransactions through GTA Online alone. That means all of those people out there have bought $500 million in shark cards, in fake money. May, how do you feel about $500 million of fake money?
People are idiots?
Yeah.
Well, we were talking about this before the podcast, you know, about how, you know, you were banned in GTA 5 last, in January, right?
Yeah, so.
And how it's interesting that, like, now that we have some actual numbers, we know why they were fighting so damn hard to protect their shit, which, you know, they have a right to. And this justifies all of the, all the actions they took against players who were duping and take, you know, making money and all that other shit.
I was memory hacking. I wasn't doing anything bad. I was legitimately, I was modifying the memory of my own computer, and that is my right. And the fact that their server trusted the data from my client is their own problem.
I agree with you.
So that's my right, but I'm not bitter. I'm not mad. I never was permabanned. I was temporarily banned. I acquired tons of cool shit. Don't you worry about that, but it happens, you know. That's what happens when you release a game on the PC. You have to understand the environment you're releasing your game into, and that, you know, we have control over our systems.
Yeah, and I'd be curious to see the percentage of these microtransactions, where they're coming from, console, PC, etc.
Oh my god.
Because this game has a story
of history. $500 million in fake money.
Why would I have to buy a $60 game and then pay microtransactions on top of that? It's ridiculous.
The question isn't why, it's just that the fact that people did it. And
yeah, I know you don't have to, but...
They are rolling in the dough.
Now, I'm not speaking against Rockstar's games at all. They make phenomenal games. And the fact that Grand Theft Auto Online 5, or Grand Theft Auto 5, sold 60 million copies, which places it up there in the top, like, two or three of all-time games ever sold.
Absolutely.
It's number one. Amazing. Well, if you discount, like, bundles, like the Nintendo...
You can't discount Tetris, yeah.
Yeah, if you discount Tetris and the Nintendo Wii Sports, which were included with every Wii, then yes, it is up there in the top seller.
Yeah, that's a lot of fucking copies. I mean...
Across PS3, 360s, PS4, PC, they've sold 60 million copies of this game.
And this game, but this game also released twice.
Twice.
Right? Once it was on old gen, once and new gen. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you may want to consider that in your number exactly, but people were willing to buy a second copy in some cases, and probably many cases.
But apparently it came with the cost of disassociating one of the lead producers, directors, developers of the game, who is now no longer part of the company, and suing them for a large portion of the profit.
Yeah, he wants his piece of the pie here.
Yeah, and honestly, I don't know what truly went down. I can suspect and have an idea. I think this guy is a creative. He probably came in there, was, you know, a creative director, producer, and helped these games along a lot of the ways. And once they were well on their way, he went off and did his own thing. And he would just come back and work on the next project, but when GTA 5 became such a success and he took his little sabbatical, they kind of had to sit back and say, well, this guy is going to get this much money when he comes back. Maybe it's better if we just find a way to fire him, you know, so he doesn't get that money.
Maybe.
And that's what it's really looking to be at this point. Because you've got not only Rockstar, but their publisher, Take-Two, and they're all involved. They're all trying to protect that money. And far be it to say that... Yeah, well, I'm not begrudging either side. I mean, Take-Two and Rockstar should be trying to protect that $150 million. That's their duty as, you know, corporate officers. But if this guy was truly involved in this project, he stands to get that money.
Indeed. Indeed he does. Get paid for, you know, his work, essentially.
But there is some light out of this whole thing. We know now that Rockstar is now officially working on a follow-up to the Red Dead series. It's apparently going to be a prequel to the Red Dead Redemption game that came out on Xbox 360, PS3, never released on PS3. One of the only Rockstar games to never release on the PC.
Yeah, and this is a this was a popular game. People loved Red Dead, and they wanted to see more of this. And so this one's gonna sell really well.
Right. So we've got some very, very good grounded evidence. We've seen maps of the environment with anonymous, postings of developers who are involved in the project saying, yes, this is true, we're working on this. So we're looking forward to it.
I think it's fair to say that. Yeah, my wife loves the Red Dead series. She will absolutely pick this up. I loved watching her play through the Red Dead Redemption and all the DLCs for that. It's a fun game. Definitely a fun game. I wish it came to PC because I would have bought it.
I know. I hope so. But I don't think it will at this point.
All right. So the next one's all yours, too. Tell us a little bit about Mr. John Romero and what he's doing now.
So John Romero, whom you may recall as the former id Software co-founder and co-creator of Doom and Quake, he is involved in a new project. This just broke the other day.
And no, it didn't.
Yes, it did.
No, we've known about this for months. We were talking about it on Twitter.
No, we've heard rumors, but this came...
It wasn't rumored. He was talking about it on Twitter. He was talking about it on Twitter. He was saying how he's making a great game, and it's going to blow our minds, and it's a shooter.
Fair enough, and here are the details. So we know that it is going to be based around this fictional... how do you even pronounce that? Hoxar?
Hoxar? That's what I've been saying, yeah.
Yeah. So they've created this kind of like alternate reality game that you can kind of start getting yourself involved in. The website is Hoxar Inc. It's HOXAR-INC.com. It's definitely going to be a shooter if we know John Romero is involved. And you can say what you like about John Romero. You know, he did Quake and Doom. And he was the lead map designer there. Did a lot of great work.
Well, he's an industry legend at this point.
He did Die Katana also.
He did. And I was about to follow up on that. He followed up with Ion Storm and their pet project, Die Katana, which fell short. That's the easy way to say it.
So it was a broken game in every way possible.
I think John learned a lot of lessons at Ion Storm. I think he learned that...
I don't think so.
It's not as much to be the front man for a game as it is to make the game. And with how quiet he's been making this game, and just now seeing... We're pretty sure this confidential source that Shaq News spoke to was John Romero. So the fact that he's just making this game, he's trying to get a little bit of news out there that, hey, I'm making a game. You should maybe take a look at it and start getting interested. But not coming out with his full flowing locks in the breeze, PC Gaming Master Race face on.
Yeah, right.
Right.
He is that guy.
That's John Merrill. Yahtzee's like vision of the PC Gaming Master Race, that's fucking John Romero. He modeled that after John Romero. The fact that we're seeing this now is phenomenal. I'm really looking forward to this project.
It is really cool. I would say the website is fascinating. It does not, there's just a lot of text on it, not a whole lot of, anything else. But what's being described on that Hoxar-Inc.com site is really what the experience of this game is going to be about. You know, this type of different type of reality, talking about how VR is the past. Right. You know, we're moving past that and we're going into some other new experience and what that's about. Like, read it. You can tell there's a lot of passion behind those words. Like, what the proof of concept is, we will see when that happens. But it piques my interest at the moment. But it's not. It's like I need something to latch on to beyond that, though.
Don't believe the lies.
No, I mean, this is good.
Don't believe Romero's lies.
We get a lot of interesting story just from that website. Like honestly, if I'm looking at that website, I'm getting a lot of vibes of like Aperture Technologies, like from Valve.
Exactly.
Abstergo from the Assassin's Creed. Like, there's something sinister and dark here behind this corporation.
I mean, the front page says Hoxar is proud to present the future of holography with Blackroom, all in caps, a fully immersive experience without physical restriction, no goggles required. Like, that's something else. Like, what's he talking about? You know, like, you got to read through it to really see what he, what it's talking about. Like, you don't, it, it's almost like, yeah, like Aperture. Like, is it real? Is it part of the game? Like, what's going on here?
I think it's fake. Yeah. It's to advertise the game.
Well, it's not fake, but they're trying to create like an AR type of experience where you're getting involved in the background, the story before the story is revealed.
I mean, like, it's going to go far beyond, it's going to replace virtual reality before virtual reality is even has a chance of releasing.
Maybe it will. This is John Merrill, the flowing locks.
No, it's not. This is just an advertisement for the game. You're going to do something with the Rockstar system. Cute. You're not going to actually have an AR system for the game.
We don't have a whole lot to say about it right now, but I think probably in the future we're going to be following up on it.
Yeah, check out the site and see what you think about it.
This is a spoof page.
All right, so Nani's going to give you your tech minute on Pascal GPUs.
So I've been thoroughly berated here about talking about technology. So I'm going to keep this one short and brief and to the point. So NVIDIA has revealed the Pascal GPU technology. It is coming out. We are expecting in the consumer cards in late May or early June. They will be successors to the current technology, the 970s, the 980s, the 980 Ti's, and the Titans. They're going to be priced about the same. They are going to be based on the new Pascal architecture, which is a 16 nanometer FinFET technology. They are not using the latest and greatest HBM2 memory. They are going to be GDDR5. What this means to you, if you're sitting on top of a 970 or 980 GTX or 980 Ti right now, you are going to pass on this generation. If you're like Gray, who's sitting on top of a 680 GTX, you may want to consider.
I may want to consider, yeah. Mm-hmm. I will definitely consider.
Now, this is a disappointment, actually. We expected a lot more from NVIDIA this time around. The HBM2 memory was supposed to be involved heavily with the Pascal 2 architecture, and it is not. They are just basically going for a stopgap here. So this is your stopgap GPU architecture. They are moving to a new form factor, or a new production model. Performance on this chipset is probably going to be 20-30% above like a 980 Ti. So if you're already there, don't bother.
But if you're not,
it's a good bet. So what we're looking to see towards the end of the year, maybe even early, like quarter one 2017, is a refresh on the HBM2, the high bandwidth memory 2 model, which is going to take the memory bandwidth from about like 9 to 12 gigabytes a second to about 64 gigabytes per second. And that is the sweet spot. That's where we're going.
It's a little disappointing that we're not getting that now, which is what we thought.
No, we're getting it is a disappointment. But I will say, everybody owns a computer. If you own a console, I guarantee you own a computer.
That's so probably true. Yeah.
Why not spend the $300, which is the cost of a console or a PlayStation 4.5, 4K refresh, and put in a good video card in your computer and make it a good PC gaming machine? I mean, that's the cost, really. You already own a computer.
Well, you'll have to try to convert people to Master Race another day, because they will fight you tooth and nail about it.
For more than a GPU? And it's costing $13,000 from what I see right now.
No. That's the Tesla. The Tesla is aimed at high-end, like, supercomputing.
Okay, so how much is this video card going to cost?
So the consumer cards, which we're expecting to hit at the end of May, early June, are going to be priced about what we see now, the 970, the 980, the 990 Ti. So about $300 to $600.
For one piece of hardware. It's not worth it.
Well, you got people dropping $800 on VR headsets right now.
But that's an entirely different experience. Well, your GPU.
AI Monster, what is a PS4.5 4K going to cost you?
That's an entire console a GPU. That's a GPU, a CPU, and everything. What was it, 400, I think it was?
Mm-hmm. So if you already own a Dell, HP, IBM computer, that's, an i5, an i7, or whatever, so you throw a $300 video card in it, and you're one step ahead of the PS4.5 already.
Yep, I mean, you can have this argument for days. You're never going to win.
Nope.
People like consoles.
There's a couch experience
involved. You know, there's a lot of factors that go into people making decisions to switch over to PC gaming. Unfortunately, graphics and power is not always the leading point of discussion.
Here's the point, though. An Xbox 360 or a PS4 is not your desktop PC. You have a desktop PC, be it a laptop, be it a physical desktop machine. So why not drop a $300 video card in and turn it into a gaming machine?
Because the only thing I need, I need a $300 video card for, is for VR. So I'm dropping more than $300 on a system.
But you can do so much more with it than VR.
Listen, you're not going to convince each other otherwise.
I really can't. It's not going to. Wow, I could see a higher resolution.
I'm not looking to change anybody's mind here. I'm just looking to opening and broadening horizons. Saying you've already got the computer, so why not put a video card in it?
I don't get hung up on resolutions and seeing every single goddamn pixel that I could possibly see. It's just not a big deal to me.
A lot of people don't, and that's why they play consoles and, you know, exclusives and all that stuff. There's a lot of factors to it. Let's not harper on the point too long. Let's move this along. Let's talk about the announcements and debuts that are we just heard about. Some of these are comical.
Where are we going here?
Why don't you start us off talking about Eve Valkyrie?
All right, Eve Valkyrie, the space sim shooter that was originally an exclusive to the Oculus Rift, is definitely confirmed to be coming out on the HTC Vive. That's right. If you don't want to play it already with some hacks.
We also knew it was coming out on PlayStation VR as well.
We always knew. It's always coming. They're not going, at least the people at CCCP are not going to be stupid and limp themselves to one platform. What else do we have? Oh, yes. So, many of you might be aware that they are rebooting the Ghostbusters franchise with an all-female cast. It looks interesting.
Interesting would be, yeah. You could use that word, I guess.
They have some of those actresses are very talented, and I'm not going to discount it right out.
They are talented, but are they talented for the type of movie that Ghostbusters should be?
We're going to see that a lot of that is going to involve the writing and the directing. However,
I mean, I love Melissa McCarthy movie, but I don't think she belongs as a cast member on Ghostbusters.
However, they are rebooting a cult franchise. This is Ghostbusters, and there are some questions. However, we can be sure that the Ghostbusters movie will be getting a video game tie-in. So expect Ghostbusters the game, July 12th.
Did you see the video of the gameplay in this game? It looks awful.
Yes, it did.
This looks like a PS2 era game or
I expected nothing less than a video game tie-in. All right. What else we have? Oh, Star Wars Battlefront. So, for the one or two Star Wars Battlefront players who might be out there, to ensure further fragmentation of your community, EA will be releasing a new expansion pack.
Hooray!
Four maps on Bespin, which is, you know, Cloud City. That one's coming in spring.
Yay, new maps. You get to pay for new maps. Exciting.
Yes, new maps that only a fraction of the players will even own.
So dumb.
Thank you, EA. May I please have another? Respawn Entertainment is officially working on Titanfall 2. Again, another fragmented community. So if you want to fragment yourself further, you may pick up Titanfall 2.
What are you talking about fragmented?
Who's playing Titanfall anymore?
Yeah, but Titanfall was a great game.
Yeah, and they fragmented the shit out of it with expansion packs.
They gave
this thing away on Origin for free for like a while, didn't they?
Well, they still are. I'm pretty sure I can go fire up Origin right now and get it.
You could use... Look. Well, the mechs have swords now.
Okay.
No, but Titanfall is a great game.
Yeah, it's free.
I don't know why then it become more popular. I have no idea why.
Because of DLC?
Could have been timing.
It didn't. I mean, it lost a lot of popularity way before any DLC got released.
It's really hard to say. Like, the game itself didn't look terribly bad. The commercials looked worse. They were all over the damn place when this game was launching.
So, man, you threw up Stellaris here. Why don't you talk about it for a sec?
I didn't really. You can probably talk about it more than I can.
You
think, huh?
Fucking scoundrel. All right. So Stellaris is a 4X game. That's, you know, a space. 4X generally means a space game with trading, exploration, research, and commodities, and all sorts. It's
spreadsheets.
It's spreadsheets in space, yes, with a very good visual back end and building.
But not boring like Eve.
No, not boring like Eve. So we talked about this one, actually. I brought it up a few times, and this is from Paradox, who, if you recall back to our December, early January podcast, Paradox, we gave a strong nod towards Publisher Developer of the Year. And Stellaris was one of the games we said, hey, we're really looking forward to this one. And so it's nice to see this one coming through here. They've got a release trailer right now. It's in early access. The game release is coming out soon, and it looks phenomenal.
It looks really nice, yeah.
This is, again, not a sequel, but a direct inheritance of the lineage of Europa Universalis or Crusader Kings 2. So expect a lot of exploration, a lot of discovery, a lot of political intrigue. I mean, if you've been looking for a 4X game along the lines of like Masters of Orion or Europa Universalis, this is the one.
Fair enough. Masters of Orion just got that remaster not too long ago.
Yeah, and that one's not been reviewed too well. They came out of early access too early.
The timing is everything.
Isn't it?
I can see myself picking up this game.
I'm probably gonna pick it up. I'm gonna wait for it to mature a little more. But
it's bad. It's a bad time though to release anything right now, from my opinion. Just a slow
it is. There's a lot of good stuff coming out. So let's talk about these other ones that you threw up here, man.
All right. So I think this might be. I can't even remember now, but it's a stealth game. It looks really interesting. It's called Shadwin.
I didn't think it looked that great. It's almost like a isometric thief-looking style game. And I don't know. I don't get a great vibe from the trailer. Maybe you do. I don't know.
It's not really isometric. It's 3D.
Well, just the way that, yeah, I guess the way that the camera's positioned in the trailer gave me the
impression
that sometimes it's in that particular style. I don't know.
Right. I'm having a hard time getting the flow of the game. Like, it definitely seems very thiefish.
Yeah, it's a stealth game. You want to drop on people or take them out.
It's a lot of physics-based gameplay in it.
The AI is going to be real scripted. You're going to be watching walking paths and stuff. Like,
I need
a bigger hook than that.
Set up a lot of environments where the solution is presented to you in a puzzle, and you just have to figure it out. Like, which area you want to blow up, or you know, which physics attribute you want to affect to your best cause. I'm not saying it's bad, just maybe that gameplay trailer doesn't present it in the best light.
I think these guys made Frozen Synapses, maybe. Somebody was saying something on the comments there.
Frozen Synapse?
Yeah, that's a good name. I mean, I'm in a good game.
Okay.
Yeah,
we'll keep an eye on it for sure.
Oh, someone will.
Yeah, it's kind of just got announced, though. I mean, there wasn't much information before this. So I don't think I've ever heard of it at all. Several developers from the Witcher series are now working on an isometric RPG. So that's interesting.
Yeah, the screenshots look all right.
They broke off the Durham thing. They're not CD Projekt Red, so.
Hey, it looks like they've got some very good art direction going on here.
It reminds me, a lot of Sword Coast Legends because I played that kind of recently. You know, those old style CRPGs with that kind of art style. A lot of fog, a lot of light, a lot of lush environments, things like that. It looks all right. It looks all right. I mean, at least we only got a couple screenshots of it, but it looks all right.
If you just showed these screenshots to me, I would probably say they were a JRPG.
Really? You get that from
me? Yeah, I mean, they're very panned out, wide, broad, colorful, very vertical. So yeah, I mean, it definitely brings back memories of like Final Fantasy VII, of oh god, what's the place you go to in the middle of the game? God, I can't remember the name. Anyway,
okay, I can see where you're coming from.
Niflheim or something. I don't know.
Niflheim.
Yeah, Niflheim.
Yeah, it's very, very vertical, very colorful.
I mean, these are Witcher 3 developers, so that alone should probably raise eyebrows. Because, yeah, one of the best RPGs of all time.
No, this is definitely one to watch. Let's see how this one develops, so to speak. No pun intended.
So I'm not sure if this was announced yet, but Severed got an official release date and a trailer to go along with it. It's April 26th, so very soon you'll be able to play it. This is a Vita game where it's a dungeon crawling game, but dungeon RPG, classic style like that. But you actually use the touchscreen to attack, so you make swipes with and attack very quickly and with the Vita touchscreen. So it's really interesting. These are the guys who made Guacamole Melee, and they made another game too, Drinkbox Studios. And all their games review very well, so I imagine this is going to do very well as well. And definitely something to look out for, if you're on a Vita.
I do not, but good luck to them.
Now, a game I'm not too excited for is Fear Effect Sedna. Mainly because this is a Fear Effect IP. The old PlayStation, what is it, PlayStation 1 game or Dreamcast? I think it was Dreamcast, actually. Help me out here.
I'm going through the archives of my memory, and this one does not come up. So I couldn't tell you.
But it was like a Dreamcast kind of survival action game.
Quite a nice Kickstarter page, though, and they're not asking for a whole lot of money.
This is one of the best looking cel shaded games back then. The original Fear Effect. But yeah, they're making it an isometric SRPG for whatever fucking reason. It's nothing like the original game. And it might hit its goal, might not. They're asking for $114,000. They have a Kickstarter.
I mean, maybe based on the budget that they proposed, this was the kind of game that they could afford to make. You know, just to get that IP back, you know, going, I guess.
If I'm not mistaken, this is Square Enix's IP, and they actually have a program where you could use their old IPs if you're an indie developer. As long as you make a good proposition for it, and this is what they actually decided to use.
Oh yeah. Okay, gotcha. Yeah, they're just trying to get the IP revived, probably.
Yeah, but it's just weird that they're making a whole completely different game with the IP revival instead of using the genre of the previous game.
Fair enough.
A lot of people are upset about that. Attack on Titan Wings of Freedom gets a Western release date. It's August 26th. So if you have a Vita or PS4, you could look forward to that. Now this game is kind of like iffy, and sometimes it looks bland, really bland, and it's just doing the same repetitive stuff over and over again, and other times it looks pretty good, but...
I did not like the anime series. Like, I'll just flat out say that now. So the game itself has no interest to me at all. I thought it was baseless, and it conformed too many like anime tropes that I just could not get involved in it.
I think it's less tropey than most anime.
Oh, come on, dude. You had the brooding young youth who wants to be the fucking best there is, but he's just complete crap. You had the silent, you know, type who's better than everybody else but doesn't let anybody know it. And then you had the fucking the pumper of the month character. Like, that's like the anime trio.
Today I learned Nautius watches anime.
Maybe older
anime. Old and new, but I've you know, picked up on the styles and the tropes and how they format the plots, and I know what's decent and what's not, and like Attack on Titan is not decent. Like it's tireless.
I know some people who would consider them fighting words.
Probably.
I'm not going to argue about that.
No, it's not. Here's not the place. But visually, the game looks good. It holds true to the anime itself. The gameplay seems to follow what you would expect from players existing in that universe, so I won't fault at that. I tried to get into it, man. I watched like the first like 8 or 9 episodes. I was like, yeah, I can't do this anymore.
Well, I'd say this next one looks nice.
Yeah, Chronicles of Teddy, Harmony of Exit. Wow, that's gonna be a Japanese game. No, it's not a Japanese game.
It's not. It's not. It's
that has to be a Japanese. Come on, it's a Japanese it's title, right?
Naughty's his favorite pixel art genre.
Yeah, it's this.
We have rules about that thing around here.
It's like Link 2, basically. Adventures of Link.
Or Metroid.
Yeah, or Metroid, I guess. I get more of a Link, Adventures of Link feeling from this one.
You will get no more love from me for retro gaming styles.
It's all right.
That's just how it is. I've had enough.
All right, so the next one
it has a unique retro game in style. Our style is unique, at least.
It's like it tries to look older than it is by having a lot of shifting pixels and stuff. You just got
You don't say.
Oh, you actually put a trailer for this one here?
Yes, I don't even know what this is, honestly, because there was
I was wondering why you posted it, because this thing...
This is
you must have picked
game.
It up because it just recently got acquired by Telltale as their publisher. But this game has been in early access since December of 2013.
The original developer and publisher on this game is the Fun Pimps Entertainment LLC.
So we're talking about 7 Days to Die, which has been a game, a survival crafting game on Steam that's been in early access for... 3 years now. Let's just say 3 years.
The release date was December 13, 2013. So, yeah.
That was the early access release date. It's still in early access.
Because that's where those games belong.
The only game that I know that's been in early access longer than this is Space Engineers.
All right, so I made a mistake putting that on there.
No, it's fine, dude. It's like, look, they have a new publisher. Telltale has obviously picked them up and are going to publish their game.
It's a curious play for Telltale because this isn't the kind of game that
we are
used to them making or publishing or standing behind or anything.
They can't use their engine for this.
This is a strange game. Like, this is a live-action survival mode. They call it the Survival Horde Crafting Game. It's a Telltale, like, that doesn't even, I mean, you look at the videos and stuff, and you look at the screenshots, this is not a game that Telltale would ever get behind. Why they picked it up, I don't know.
It's probably you put tower defense elements on here. Why?
That's what it said.
The article
I don't know,
wrong.
Whatever.
This is a weird one for Telltale. I don't know why they would, maybe they have an idea for this.
If you want a new DayZ, this is your game.
Not new tasting. Okay. I don't know. Anyway, let's move on. This is a strange one.
All right, so we got a PlayStation VR game coming out called Loading Human. It's like a adventure style game where you walk around and do stuff.
Yep.
You interact with robots, and the voice acting is pretty bad at the trailer.
It's pretty bad. It's pretty bad.
So, sometime later this year, when the PSVR comes out, you can play this one.
Yeah,
They got a lot of stuff to do in the game, but the voice acting then kind of ruins the experience.
The graphics look like the old Rockstar GTA, San Andreas.
Yeah, it's not good graphics, but I mean,
the game PlayStation VR is
interesting, but that voice acting is probably the worst.
No, this is good. This is kind of showing us like what to expect from PSVR games.
I would hope that this is not what we can expect.
No, this is not a showcase.
Because this is bad.
All right, well, we'll see.
It's way better already.
All right, well, that's all the announcements and debuts. Let's shoot through the upcoming games, give you an update on our fantasy draft, and get the hell out of here.
Gotta go through here really quickly. So I just want to mention that several games are getting PS4 or Xbox One or both releases that were previously on PC. Battle Worlds Chronos, which is a strategy RPG, Lichdom, Battle Mage, Invisible Incorporated, and Blues and Bullets.
All right.
Danganronpa 2 Goodbye Despair is getting a PC release. It's originally a Vita game. It's a visual novel slash mystery game, and that's coming out on April 18th.
Mañana.
So tomorrow. The Banner Saga 2 is a strategy RPG. Critically acclaimed Banner Saga game, obviously. PC. April 19th. Melty Blood is actually getting released in the West.
Oh, dear God. Finally.
Yeah, it's only been, what, 5 years? 6 years? 7 years? 10 years? I don't know.
Another Lotus fighting game.
Yes. But it is getting released, and it's for PC April 19th. It's a little risk because it's so old. It looked good back then.
I know.
Langrisser Reincarnation Tensei. It's a Japanese name, obviously. Strategy, yes. RPG for free DS. Actually, it's pretty good. It's an Atlas game. So if you like Fire Emblem, maybe pick this one up. It's coming out April 19th. Sorry. Axiom Verge is coming out for Vita. It's also on PC and PS4. It's a Metroidvania style game. Again, very critically acclaimed. I think this rated in a 90 plus.
This one was good. Ask, this one was like game of the year for a lot of people.
Yeah, so.
It belongs on Vita for sure.
Metroidvanias work well on this system. Masquerade Baubles of Doom. I have no idea what this game is, what genre this fits in, because they haven't shown any gameplay. I can only find story elements. But it's coming out on Xbox One. It's exclusive to Xbox One.
Enjoy your game.
Enjoy the game, whatever it is, because they haven't advertised what the gameplay is supposed to be like, as far as I could tell. Pollen. That's with periods in between each letter. I'm not going to say each letter out.
No, this one is called Pollen. It is a first-person exploration adventure. It's one of the better-looking ones right now. It is going to be for PC with VR support for Oculus and Vive via Steam. Looks really good.
April 20th, if you want to pick that up, and you have your Vive or Oculus at this point. Because none of us do.
Nope. Waiting on it. I'm jealous. It's coming at some point. Probably when I'm on vacation. It's going to come when I'm on vacation, and I'm going to have to be on the phone with FedEx and HTC, getting the fucker redirected to like a FedEx shipping center so I can go pick it up. It's going to be a pain in the butt. I guarantee it.
All right, I think you put the next one on here as well.
I did. This is Warhammer Battlefleet Gothic Armada. This is a space real-time strategy based in the Warhammer universe. Order versus Chaos. If you're into games like StarCraft or Sins of the Solar Empire, this one's up your alley. This one's a cheap one. It's like $40. Looks really good.
$40 is cheap now?
$40 is cheap for a full-fledged PC RTS, yeah. RTSs just don't sell like they used to.
Yeah.
Yeah, because they're too overpriced. Anyway, Star Fox...
They have more fucking replayability than 90% of the games out there, man.
Speaking of replayability, Star Fox Guard is coming out. Star Fox Zero, I believe. It's like a defense shooter. I mean, it has more on-rail shooting, but there's like a defense element to it. So, it's coming out on Wii U. April 22nd, it's bundled with Star Fox Zero, I believe, but it's considered a
separate Star game. Fox Zero, which is Papa J's game draft pick.
Yes, it's going to be, it's like a 7th pick or something, but it's his first game that's coming out, so he gets to actually score.
I don't think he's going to score too well.
No, I don't either. It is an on-rail shooter. It is space combat, and it does not look very good in my opinion.
No,
but it'll probably,
it looks bad.
Probably get points for being Nintendo. You know,
and they're already throwing controversy. We talked about it. Like, it's going to have like an invincible mode where you can just play through the game and be invincible and just play through the game and see the whole story without ever being at risk.
That amazing Star Fox story.
It's a damn shame, because...
Dual barrel roll!
That is one of the IPs that, you know, people kind of have, like, a good past memory of, and they just don't feel like giving it justice for whatever
reason. I would like to be pleasantly surprised on this one, but I just don't see it happening.
It might just review high because it's Nintendo.
God, I hope not.
Yeah, it's be wary of this one.
I mean, my only hope is they evaluate it on, you know, story, gameplay, depth, you know, all the general criteria that we would rate a AAA game. I mean, look how long it take them to make this thing.
Yeah, right.
But
it's because they had to revamp the whole game because the controls sucked.
But no, you're right. It's going to get the 20-point Nintendo bonus.
And yeah, we talked about it before, but Severed is a dungeon RPG. Releasing on Vita, April 26th. Another dungeon RPG releasing on Vita. This is actually on pretty much every other system at this point. I think it's releasing on Steam as well, actually. What did you misread as?
Oh, no, I'm sorry. The next one. I was looking at the next one. I was looking at Stranger of Sword City. I thought like they're doing like a Sword of the Stranger. And I was like, I actually like Sword of the Stranger.
No, this is Stranger of the Sword City we're talking about.
Oh, I know, but... Two different titles. I was thinking of, you know, Sword of the Stranger, the anime.
More anime.
I do watch anime from time to time.
You should watch good anime.
Well, Sword of the Stranger is up there.
But yes, it's releasing Vita. Actually, it's pre-ordered. April 26th. Alien Nation is an isometric action shooter exclusive to PS4. Lots of PlayStation exclusives this week. Coming out April 26th. This is a big one. They advertise this a lot, actually. It's kind of like a co-op. It's a co-op shooter. It's kind of like in Vein of Crimson Land where they just throw monsters at you. Or even the that Steam game that was free for the longest period. It's still free, but... It has Alien in the title, too. Help me out here.
Alien free on Steam.
Alien Swarm, I think it is. Is that it?
Alien Swarm.
Alien Swarm is like the team-based, you know, Left 4 Dead style isometric game.
Yeah, that's what kind of like this is.
Oh, okay. I could get behind this.
King's Quest Chapter 3 is releasing.
I should be able to comment on this one, and I am remiss in my duties. Like, I played the King's Quest Chapter 1. Chapters 2 is in my backlog right now. But next podcast, I'll try to get caught up.
It shouldn't take that long either.
No, I really liked it. Like, if you haven't played, like, the King's Quest Chapter 1, you should. It's, you know, it's very well done. The artistic direction is phenomenal for what they're trying to do. The dialogue is funny. The voice acting is done really well. Like, this is a underrated series.
I'll just wait till I really salt.
I know, you should. And I always tell people, just wait till all the chapters are out, because I think I played the first chapter in, like, July of last year. So
it's taking forever.
They take a while. Like, these chapters are not Telltale chapters. They don't come in a couple weeks.
Or even Life is Strange or any of his other episodic games. Yeah,
but this one's worth playing, and I'll keep you guys updated. I will definitely play through the next two chapters because I have the season pass. But, yeah, I know.
But yeah, it's coming out PS4, PC, Xbox One, April 26th. Hyper Devotion Noir, Goddess Blackheart. Again, you can tell the title's Japanese.
Of course it is.
Yes, this is a compile hard game, so yeah, I'll just say that right now.
Alright, moving
on. SRPG.
It is on the Vita.
PC, and it was an old Vita game that's now released on PC. It's like Danganronpa.
There's been a lot of that lately.
Yeah, they're bringing the games over. Pretty much all the Japanese developers now, except like Atlus, release games on PC. Yeah. And Nintendo, of course.
Okay, it's good. I like it. Sometimes they have a little trouble with the ports, but other than that, I think it's a great idea.
Lost Reavers is releasing for the Wii U. It is an action RPG dungeon co-op style game. Yeah, it's free to play, so that's interesting. Wii U game that's free to play. I don't think there's many of those.
It's coming out.
Yeah, coming out April 28th, 2016. Portal Stories VR, and it's coming out on PC. It was popular in Japan, obviously. Coming out on PC. I don't think this is coming out on Steam, so I'll just make note of that. It's Manga Gamer, I believe you get it from. Is it coming out on Steam? I see.
Well, I'm just devastated.
Yeah. Well, if you're looking for an Otome dating sim,
it has a listing on Steam with the release date of April 29th. So yeah,
get it on Manga Gamer. I don't think it's has a Rogue content. New Odds Mafia is a Otome dating sim, a pretty popular one from what I understand, and it's coming out on PC. Was popular in Japan, obviously. Coming out on PC. I don't think this is coming out on Steam, so I'll just make note of that. It's Manga Gamer, I believe you get it from. Is it coming out on Steam? I see.
Well, I'm just devastated.
Yeah. Well, if you're looking for an Otome dating sim,
it has a listing on Steam with the release date of April 29th, so yeah.
Get it on Manga Gamer. I don't think it's has a Rogue content, nudity or whatever. But yeah, it's a dating sim. If you don't know what Otome is, I say it all the time, but it's a dating sim geared towards females, so it has one female and a bunch of males trying to court her. But it's coming out PC April 29th.
Super exciting.
Not holding my breath.
All right, so let's wrap up by giving you guys an update on the fantasy video game draft that we had in December. A couple of release date, well, one release date change.
Qualified expert.
Yeah. Gears of War 4 is releasing on October 11th, and that is Papa J's pick. So we'll see how that does. Star Fox Zero is upcoming, we just announced, April 22nd. That is also Papa J pick. So hopefully he'll score some points.
We'll see.
And here's a finalized, in flux scores, more or less, from recent times. Dark Souls 3 is now at an 88 Metacritic. That's Naughty's pick. Ratchet & Clank, we mentioned earlier, 86, is also Naughty's pick. Those are two great scores.
Adrift. I don't know. I'm kind of disappointed with the Dark Souls 3.
I was, too.
That scored over 90.
Why would you be?
I thought low 90s for Dark Souls 3.
No. Hey, listen, 88, 89, it's a great score for that game.
That was the first round, first pick. Like, that should have been 90s. I'm going to pay
for that. Hey, you win some, you lose some.
Persona is going to be the highest score game. Just called it now.
Hey, Adrift, which was a VR game that was my pick, scored a 66. That's terrible.
Did not do so well. That's unfortunate, because that's a premier. That was like a premier AAA VR game.
Yeah. Should have seen it coming. It was going to be a shit game. Ashes of Singularity was Seifert's pick. That is at 74 at the moment.
Yeah, that's your real-time strategy in the vein of like Total Annihilation and Supreme Commander.
That dropped significantly.
That shouldn't have gotten that low. It should not have been that low. But what killed it was lack of single-player story.
Yeah, RTS needs to have single-player, needs to have multiplayer.
Fuck you, Blizzard.
That's a lot. Yeah, just the standard is where it's at. Firewatch is Naughty's pick to 79. Street Fighter V, which was AI, at 76. The Witness, 87. That's another AI pick. Unravel, which was my pick, Gray's pick, 78. And XCOM 2 is holding pretty steady at in a score of 88. And that was a C for pick.
I really want to see how that score holds up through the year, because we know like Fireaxis is working on console ports of that game. So that could drop.
Yeah, maybe.
Okay, maybe.
But it's the only game in here that didn't drop a point over the last 2 years.
No, not yet. But we know, like, okay, XCOM came out to consoles, so XCOM 2 is a foregone conclusion. It's coming. Just will it be this year?
Again, don't hold your breath. I think 88.
I think it is. I think that score is going to lose, I'll say it now, 3 or 4 points.
We'll find out in December.
I think once it gets onto consoles, the console players are going to bitch about the controls, and it's going to drop because of
it. That could hurt it, yeah. That could hurt it. I could see that.
I think I'm going to win this one.
All right, so that wraps up the 62nd episode of the IGC podcast. We will see you again in 2 weeks on Sunday, May 1st, for our 63rd podcast episode. If you like what you hear, please follow this Twitch channel, and you can also check us out on Twitter at @impact_gamingcm, on YouTube at Impact Gaming Videos, where all these podcasts end up, as well as some highlights from our community guilds, Neutral Impact, Divisional Impact, our art guys, whatever else is going on up there. And of course, you can find this podcast by searching for us on for IGC Podcast on iTunes. Check out our streamings on our website at impact-gaming.us. You can apply to any of our major chapters, gamer groups, etc., or become a streamer of your own if you like. That about wraps up the podcast. Really happy to have you guys. Thanks for the audience. Thanks to you, AI, for coming, and Naughties for coming. Had a pretty good show. Hopefully next time we'll get Papa J, who isn't dying on a bed somewhere because he's replacing a roof. See you guys in 2 weeks on Sunday, May 1st, actually. And until then, game on.